We begin our day out in West Dorset, in the town of Bridport. Now, with a name like that, you might expect that it was right on the coast, but it isn't. In fact, it's a mile or so inland, though it is connected to the English Channel by the River Brit, and in medieval times, boats could actually sail as far as the town.
Well, today it's a very prosperous and lively place, which really isn't all that surprising when you consider that it is slap in the middle of a major tourist area. But really, the town owes its original prosperity to the fact that it specialised in the production of rope, of net, and of twine, all essential items to sailors and to fishermen.
It's been suggested that the main streets of Bridport are as wide as they are because a lot of space was needed for rope making. There's no real evidence for that, but what is certain is that the long alleyways amongst the houses were used for that purpose. And if you want to find out more about the history of rope making, then the museum is the place to go. Displays here illustrate how it all started with the Romans, who planted hemp in the surrounding valleys. Then, how the rope trade, already in existence by the 13th century, was given a great boost by an order from King John to supply the navy. From then on, it went from strength to strength. And if you come at the right time, there's an added bonus.
Well, Francis Sanctuary gives demonstrations of how the rope was made here in Bridport, traditionally, right up until about the turn of the century. Mm-hmm. And so we've got the wonderful old machinery here, Francis. Perhaps you can explain exactly what you do.
Well, to begin with, we have started off by making three strands out of 6 yards in each strand. We're cutting out the actual spinning of the yarn. You'll probably see that there are six. Mm-hmm. And these are fixed onto the three spinning cogs, the hooks, which are going to rotate whilst we're actually twisting the strands. And as we turn the handle, as Anthony turns the handle, the strand will twist in the opposite direction. Mm-hmm. And as the swivel at the other end is allowing it to go quite freely, then those three will twist again in the other direction to make the rope.
This is sort of laid along what would have been an old rope
walk. This would have been
a
rope
walk.
We've got a very short piece of rope walk. We've only got one skirder, which there would have been a line of skirders all along the walk, simply to keep it at a usual, easy working
height. So it isn't
You're nice and tall, so you'll be able to negotiate the skirder and lift this over it, because this is your weapon. This is the top, which is, if you have that way up, you'll see why it's called a top, I think. And that is going to guide the three strands and keep them nice and even. So in order to start it off, we must put the strands carefully into the grooves.
We've got Harold at the other end there
holding the swivel hook.
Right.
And you're going to face the way you're going. Put one hand on the top there. Mm-hmm. That's right. And keep them in that sort of triangle.
Right.
So can we start?
Okay.
Some nice twist, please.
That's not a bad bit of rope.
We'll see. Now, if you put the top down so that it doesn't smash, thank you.
Right.
Now, we really see what sort of an apprentice you were.
I would have been paid, Harold was telling me, all of nearly £2 a week for doing this.
That's a beautiful piece of rope. Well done, well done. That's wonderful.
Oh, yes. There's a few people who'd like to see that.
Local folk have also made netting for centuries, and today mass production means that Bridport has the largest net-making business in Europe.
You know, it's not really until you stop and think about it that you realise just how much netting we still use in our everyday lives. That, for instance, is a little piece of netting that you'd find on an aircraft. The seat in front of you would have that attached to it to take newspapers, magazines and all those information booklets. Industry, probably the major user of netting now, fishing of course, and sport. Every significant sporting event in the world has used nets made here in Bridport. The Olympics, the World Cup, snooker. Who can get away from that these days? A little snooker pocket, handmade here in Bridport, and tennis as well, of course. The nets for the Wimbledon Championship, made now by machine, but up until just a few years ago, the net for the centre court at Wimbledon was always handmade by Mrs. Harry Crabb, who lived in a village just outside the town. The River Brit flows out through sluice gates into what is now Bridport's harbour, West Bay. When the writer Daniel Defoe came here in 1722, he noted that there was no harbour as such at all. The fishermen just used the beach to mend their nets and sell their mackerel. The harbour that was constructed 20 years after his visit is still in use, though now mainly for leisure activities, because West Bay has become a holiday resort. You know, I reckon if it didn't have the sea in front of it, this strangely weathered mass of golden rock wouldn't look out of place in a cowboy film. And the views along the coastline are definitely on the epic scale. Just along to the west is Charmouth, another popular seaside resort. The oldest building in the village is the Queen's Arms Hotel, named in honour of Catherine of Aragon, who stayed here in 1501. And there's a fascinating story behind the plaque that informs us that Charles II slept here. When Charles II was defeated by Cromwell at the Battle of Worcester, he decided, rather wisely, that it was time to leave England for the safety of France. And so he made an arrangement with a sea captain here in Charmouth to carry him across the Channel. And in order to do this, Charles disguised himself as a servant, travelling with a young couple who were supposedly going to elope. Well, the three arrived in Charmouth. They stayed at the hotel and waited for the captain to arrive. But he didn't come. It seems that the captain's wife suspected that her husband might be involved in something slightly underhand. And clearly she was no royalist, because after all, most people knew that Charles was somewhere in the county and was probably going to try and escape off this shore. So she locked her husband in his room and hid his trousers. Well, meanwhile, the local blacksmith noticed that one of the three horses used by the travellers was shod in a way that was typical of Worcester, while the local ostler was slightly surprised when he saw that his three guests had left their horses saddled overnight in the stable. Well, their suspicions were aroused, so they informed the parson, who in turn told the magistrate, who then went to tell the captain of the local horse troop, who was stationed in a nearby village. Well, unfortunately, this was all so long-winded that by the time they were able to do anything about it, Charles had, as it were, made other arrangements and was safely on his way across the English Channel towards France. This truly wonderful stretch of coast has been designated a heritage coast, and it's particularly famous for the fossils to be found here. That's one of the main reasons for opening a Heritage Coast Information Centre here at Charmouth. Richard Edmonds, the warden, explains.
Many people who come down here, of course, they've heard about the fossils, come on their holidays, And they want to know. They want to know exactly what to look for, and it is very hard to start with. Which is really why we've established this place, the Charmouth Heritage Coast Centre, as a place for many holidaymakers to come down, find out where to look for fossils, how to find them, the correct way, the safe ways to find fossils, largely speaking.
So what do you tell them when you come, when you say the safe way and the correct way? What is it?
Well, many people are right. They know that the fossils come from the cliffs, and naturally they assume that's the place to look. The cliffs are the place to look. But unfortunately, it is not. It's very, very dangerous to collect fossils in the cliff. Yeah, as a general rule, you find very poor fossils, mostly squash fossils. The harder fossils tend to be washed out in the landslips at certain parts along the beach there, which is the place I advise people to go to.
And of course, if you do it safely, then there are wonderful rewards, aren't there? This is one that you found, a particularly large one, isn't it? Tell us something about that.
This is an ammonite, absolutely perfect in crystalline calcite. And these things are in large, quite hard rocks. You can break them open, and inside, the ammonite shows up. This one actually took 3 weeks to clean up. I actually had to chisel away with a small hammer. You can see how I've chiseled away on this side here.
That's a marvellous
specimen. Don't come out very easily at all.
These smaller ones, they were fairly easy to find, aren't they?
Yes, well, these are the things you start with. It took me 7 or 8 years to actually get to the stage of finding a fossil like that one there. These ones here can be found on your first visit to Charmouth. If you go down to the large landslips, the Black Bend landslip, for instance, these fossils in fool's gold are washed out of the soft clay onto the beach. And just a bit of patience and some sharp eyes, and you can certainly find things like that.
And this, of course, must be your absolute pride and joy. It's a beautifully preserved fish. You can see every little scale, the tail, the fins. How old would this be, Richard?
That's 190 million years, give or take. Quite how much, I wouldn't like to say. Not mine, I must emphasise. We've been donated this or on a long-term loan to the centre by one of the local collectors. It lived in a time when Charmouth certainly wasn't here. It was there's a large, warm, tropical sea covering the area. A lot of clay being laid down very, very quickly. And these were all animals swimming about in that water in the time. When they died, they sank onto the seafloor and slowly became covered by all these clays and limestones. Beautifully preserved.
What are the chances of finding something like that?
Very, very remote. I know people who have been collecting for years and years and have never found a fish like that, ever.
Just behind the cliffs, in the village of Morecambe Lake, there's an old established family business where visitors are invited to come and look around. It's run by the Moores family, who started as general bakers 130 years ago. But now, production has been concentrated on biscuits, and they make anything up to 60,000 of them every day. Also make those traditional and extraordinarily brittle biscuits called Dorset Knobs. For economic reasons, it's normally a winter job, but one batch is being made specially for our visit today. They have three separate bakings to make them extra crisp and brittle. So I don't quite understand why, after all that, they're traditionally eaten after being soaked in a cup of tea. The church at Whitchurch Canonicorum is unique. It's the only parish church in England to house a shrine containing the relics of its patron saint. The saint in question is St. Witta, which is spelt W-I-T-E. But no one knows exactly who St. Witta was.
The most popular theory is that she was a local woman who lived here in the 9th century. It's thought that she was something of a hermit or an anchoress. But apart from just spending her life in Christian prayer and contemplation, she also went out to visit and administer to the sick. Now, it's said that she was martyred by the Danes, who made a huge attack on this part of the coast in the year 831. Now, the evidence that supports this theory comes from the fact that King Alfred, whose life was dedicated to protecting Christians from the Danes, actually built a church on this very site, which he dedicated to St. Witta just a few years after that raid. And it's interesting that up there, there's a lovely carving of a Viking ship which could have come from an earlier Saxon church to be put into that medieval tower. And this is the shrine. It's made out of local stone, and a few years ago it cracked open just here, and for the first time it was possible to look inside. And in there they found a lead cask which had on it an inscription in Latin dedicated to St. Witta. And further investigation proved that inside that cask there were indeed the bones of a smallish woman who was 40 years old. Now, St. Witta's clearly always been very closely associated with the sick, which would explain why there are these three holes in the front of the shrine.
The idea is that you should put your arm, your leg, your head, or whatever part of the body is affected inside the holes to get as close to the relic as possible. And if the person who's sick isn't able to come themselves, then they would send a representative bringing a handkerchief or a bandage, and that would be put inside close to the relic and then taken back and wrapped around the affected part. Pilgrims still come here, and inside the holes there are dozens of postcards and letters, all of them asking St. Witta for help. Some of them are absolutely heartbreaking, but others do have hope because they say thank you for help that's been given in the past. The thing that I find absolutely extraordinary about this shrine is that while it's obviously not as well known as, say, the shrine at Lourdes, nevertheless, it has stood here and been a focus of attention, a point of pilgrimage for the sick, for more than 1,000 years.
Parnham, near Bemminster, is one of those country houses that has changed its appearance over the centuries. The first mansion, built about 1400, had a thatched roof, but it started to look much as it does today in Elizabethan times. In 1810, John Nash was commissioned to convert it into a romantic Gothic building, and he added the battlements and pinnacles. Then in 1910, it was decided to landscape the gardens with terraces, balustrades, gazebos, and water channels. During the 1920s, Parnham became a country club, and one guest who stayed here was woken in the middle of the night to the ghostly baying of dogs in the grounds. He was Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, and the incident inspired him to write The Hound of the Baskervilles. Years ago, Parnham was acquired by John Makepeace, a leading furniture designer. He moved his workshops here and created a centre not just to produce specially designed furniture, but also to teach aspiring craftsmen and encourage the general public to appreciate modern design.
There is my own workshop where there are 8 craftsmen who work with me to design and make individual commissions. And really, the move to Parnham enabled us to set up the Parnham Trust, which runs the School for Craftsmanwood with its 20 students here on a 2-year course, preparing for setting up their own businesses. And they come from various parts of the world, and well, more than 9 out of 10 out of them are already running businesses. And I think it's helpful for visitors to Parnham to see that the traditions are marvellous, we respect them, but that for the 20th century we have to progress. And we see that fusion at Farnham and the paradox, but which is what is so often regarded as paradox, of fine things of the 20th century in an old house.
Well, let's take a look at some of the fine things of the 20th century. This perhaps is one of the most famous pieces, your desert island chair. Tell us about this.
Well, it really reflects this point that furniture is not just about pure function. It's far more than that, and of course fine furniture has always been to do with a reflection of our time.
It is comfortable, actually, isn't it?
Yes, that's right. One is looking, I believe, for something that is going to be relaxing, that is expressive of or evocative of what people so often trace off to the other side of the world, to get among colours, to get in their own space, to get away from people. And actually, you know, to be able to be in touch with nature and yet at one at home seems to me a great fantasy and pleasure.
You do look very comfortable. All you need are the 8 records in there. Let's take a look at this, because I think perhaps this is slightly more conventional, but certainly very 20th century. Now, what was the main design feature here?
Well, the client has a very interesting room in a Victorian house, up a short staircase, and so the table is first seen as you go up the stairs. Mm-hmm. So the underneath is an important feature of it. But also, in this case, we're trying to overcome this recurring question of how do you support a table with a central column of some kind that is more interesting. So in a case like this, we've worked with structural engineers to resolve how we can use wood, how it can be bent in a number of layers. So there are something like 18 layers in each of these elements, and then those connected to provide as a kind of bracing. So it's a three-dimensional cross-bracing to give us sort of strength and stiffness within that.
And when you come to the top, again, this beautiful shape using the grain, so imaginatively.
Yes, that's a combination of tangential grain, what we sometimes call crown grain, and radial grain. So you get quite a contrast showing the different characteristics that come out of timber from the same tree.
And these side pieces that are all integral to this unit, yes?
Yes, there are a couple of cabinets with rotating drums for storage inside, either for drinks, and I think the other one will probably be used for storing table silver.
You're using a combination of woods again?
Yes. Externally, we have the cherry wood and wenge from East Africa. The interior is entirely lined with bird's eye maple.
Makes a fascinating dining room suite, doesn't it? And over there, a chair which I think is absolutely lovely. Can we go and take a look?
Yes, really.
There's a ecclesiastical feel to this chair almost, all, isn't there?
Yes, that really came from the fact that it was designed to go with a chess set, and the chess set was all made reflecting the form of the bishop's mitre.
Wonderfully tactile piece of furniture. I mean, you just feel you have to touch these lovely curves.
Right.
And again, this looks as if it would be totally fragile, but it's very solid and very strong.
Yes, this is nickel silver, used instead of cane. Enormously strong. I mean, each strand of it has great strength in it. And the weaving of that, as you can imagine, was quite a task.
Another famous piece of furniture is your bed. It's made out of a single piece of wood, isn't it?
Made from a single tree, yes. And yew trees, of course, generally have so many flaws in them, but it was bought from a timber merchant who very kindly had been sort of keeping this tree for some special circumstance. Only after getting to know me quite well was he prepared to sell it. And because of the bowed shape, that is reflected in the shape of the bed.
And so back down to the coast again, to a point about halfway along the Chesil Beach, that remarkable long strip of pebbles that stretches from West Bay all the way down to Portland, which you can just see in the distance. We're at Abbotsbury, a most charming and historic village. Its very name comes from the monastery that was founded here in the 11th century, and the estate came into the possession of the Strangways family, who are still the major landowners in the area, at the dissolution of the monasteries. Most of the buildings were destroyed at that time, but the tithe barn survived, probably because it served a very practical purpose. And up on the nearby hill, St. Catherine's Chapel also escaped destruction. It's always been a useful landmark for sailors. The Abbotsbury Subtropical Gardens offer a display that's unique in Britain. This sheltered valley has been the home of a wonderful array of exotic and climatically vulnerable plants for more than 200 years. It really is an enchanting place to wander around. And not far away, there's another unusual sight to see. Just behind the high bank of the Chesil Beach lies what's called the Fleet, the largest lagoon in Britain. And here, at the Abbotsbury Swanery, you can find the only colony of managed swans in the world. The swan herd, John Fair, explains just why the Fleet has proved to be such an ideal habitat.
In fact, it's the biggest natural food source for mute swans in the British Isles. It's called eelgrass. The water's shallow, no motorboats or sailing boats, one of the problems to swans in this country, and no power lines to fly into. Who wants to go anywhere else?
Absolutely perfect, and they've been coming here for years, haven't they?
Yes, our first record goes back to 1393, and they have actually been nesting on this site in the same way as they do now, but close together. It's a colony of mute swans, where they nest cheek to jowl, which creates problems for the cygnets. The earlier ones to nest, we actually take from the nest site. I mean, those stakes mark where the nests were. They have now been washed away by spring tides. We take a pair of swans from the nest, put their cygnets in a bucket. You know, you can get 10 cygnets in a bucket quite easily at that size. And we put the parents in there and then give them other ones to foster from other nests. But we don't actually take all the young off the other pairs. Every pair of swans that's nested here, which is 68 pairs this year, on a site which is only big enough for 6 pairs, actually will have a chance to rear some of their own cygnets. They don't all make it. Some do, some don't.
You do feed them here as well, don't you? So shall we go on?
Feed them here, but normally we don't. Of course, when they go around that corner where those cormorants are sitting, then the rest of the time they are feeding on natural food and they have nothing to do with humans at all. They won't come anywhere near us, although they all know us.
Well, let's make the most of it now, shall we?
Yep. We've got a bucket here.
Right. Do we know they're going to be fed, John?
Yes, I think they do.
They recognise the bucket, do they?
Yes. The bucket is the operative word, or anybody being here. Yeah. We'll have to hold the bucket up. Well, they'll all come up and poke their head in the bucket.
So a scoop of it, just out onto the water?
And spread it out as far as you can. Oh, lovely, that's splashing. That's right. Now go the other way.
And the other way, right. There you go.
It's rather interesting that they're called mute swans, but you notice they're not mute at all. There's a lot of talking going on there.
Well, we've come across some beautiful locations on Day Out, but for me, this really has to rank as one of the most memorable.